We begin to look at this particular passage of scripture from the book of Corinthians, dealing with one by the name of Paul. Paul was one that was a chief apostle. He was one, as the scripture details and lets us know, that he was an apostle called out of due time. All right. And the reason that he was called out of due time is because he was a replacement for one by the name of Judas. He replaced Judas because of Judas portraying Jesus. The importance of the resurrection is that Jesus died not for himself, but for us. Amen. He paid a price for which he did not owe. Paid a price for mankind. He paid a price for people that had despised and rejected him. He paid a price, amen, for generational individuals that would come even until this day. He paid a price. Amen. And the reason that he paid the price, he said, I have come that you may have life. And not only that you may have it, but you may have it more abundantly. He came that we would have a quality of life. He gave a man a chance and an opportunity. He gave woman a chance and an opportunity. Because the Bible says that while we were dead in our trespasses and in our sins, Christ died for us. He died for us. He gave us a chance and an opportunity to become or to be resurrected. And as we, before, as I use the analogy of dealing with Nicodemus, the great ruler over the Jews, he came to Jesus. He asked him, dealing with his resurrection. But even as scholarly as Nicodemus was, he could not find him. He could not understand what Jesus was talking about. Jesus, when he dealt with resurrection, he dealt with the fact that I have to die. Come on. Come on. And since he said, I have to die, you got to die. And what he means by that is that you have to die to your own personal self. You have to die to your own personal analogy. You have to die to your own will and to your own flesh. It brings about a quality of life when we follow what God is saying through his word. He lets us know that if there be no Christ, there is no resurrection. It is very profound to understand what God is talking about here through Paul. He is expressing the mere fact that if Jesus never came, we would still be in trouble. We would still be in a process of what we call death. We would be in a process of doing things incorrectly. And I talked to some other individuals. They said, well, you know, the Klan has a terminology. And I read their description of what they feel or their philosophy. And it's so backwards. You know, it's bad when people read the Bible but get a misinterpretation of what the Word of God is talking about. And they cannot properly exegete the scripture. We begin to look at this, and I looked at it, and I said, what are they talking about? What are they saying? What is their justification for hatred? And I began to look at it, and their justification is not in the Word of God. The scripture that they talk about, they have not properly executed that particular scripture. Because when they deal with, when God dealt with those particular individuals, when God dealt with that, it had nothing to do with their color or their culture, but it had something to do with their theology of thinking. Because God said, I have no other God before me.
Yeah.
So anyway, when you look at these particular scriptures, when you see the word of God, what is God talking about? God is saying that we have to move from the personality of flesh and walk in what God has designed for our lives. We have to walk in the scripture according to the word of God, that we must die to our flesh. The scripture, one profound scripture, Paul says that I am yet now crucified with Christ, therefore I no longer live. In other words, my thought pattern, the way that I think, the way that I do things that are worldly, amen, I no longer live that way, because I've been there, I've done that. Amen. What's important to me is, he said, I would rather lose everything and to gain Christ.
Yes.
Because the scripture says to win Christ is to gain. But when you look at the world will tell you that everything is good in the world. And we must follow this lifestyle. We have to live in this the sexual lifestyle. Jesus has given us authority, and he's given us power. He's given us the strength to understand that if we die to the world, and if we walk in him, that's why the importance, that's why he tells us profoundly and prophetically, he says, if any man be in Christ, he is what but a new creature. All things are passed away. Say somebody, I got to die. I got to die to me. Amen. Amen. Now, you have within yourself, you have made all kinds of decisions. You have within yourself, you have told yourself, yes, what I'm doing is correct.
Uh-huh.
And when you look at these particular situations, sometimes it seems right in your own mindset. Amen. But sometimes within yourself, because according to the scripture, every man and woman has a measure of faith. In other words, whether a person is saved or not, they got a measure. In other words, that measure will cause you to have a conscience to the point to where you'll say, man, what I'm doing, I don't think it's right. What I'm doing is not correct. You know, that's why you have individuals that are in the legal system. They know what to do is right. They don't do everything right, like we all at times, because of our humanity. Amen. But when you look at the word of God, God is trying to show us through his revelatorial revelation that if we would allow ourselves to become born again, if we will allow ourselves to be resurrected in Christ, everything will be all right. The thing that we have to realize, that if we want to be a new creation, if we really want to be resurrected, our lifestyle has to change. Amen. Look at somebody and say, our lifestyle got to change. We can't be the same. Amen. We don't want to be, as the scriptures say, a false witness. Amen. You have people, they say, yes, I have a conscience of God. Amen. I love God. And I was talking to a young man the other day. He said, well, I was talking to my soon-to-be mother-in-law, and she has a love for God, but she hasn't been to church, and she hasn't done this, she hasn't done that. Well, she don't love God. Amen. You can't say you love God, but you never show some signs. Somebody say, show some signs. Amen. And, you know, I can't tell my wife I love her, but she never see any signs. If I don't never bring her flowers, how can I say that I love her? If I never kiss her, amen, how can I say I love her? Amen. It's just like Jesus. Amen. He lets us know through the word of God. And you got folks that they say, well, I love my neighbor. I love this individual. I love that. Jesus lets us know. Amen. You talking about you love me whom you never seen, but your brother that you see every day. Amen. You don't show no signs that you love him. Amen. The Bible said you are lying. The truth is not in you. Amen. If I was dead today, I would say, Lord, resurrect me now. Hallelujah. Amen. God is trying to show us through his word. He's trying to give us a terminology, a sense of what he's saying here.